Ruth chapter 1, verse 14. And I want to talk about leaving God's will. Leaving God's will, which always causes a believer to barrenness. Leaving God's will. And I want that to sink in one's heart today. Leaving God's will. Because throughout the Bible, you find patriarchs leaving God's will. And it will always cause barrenness. Leaving God's will. I'm reading out of Ruth chapter 1, verse 14. And my title is Leaving God's Will. And I want to read, I'm going to start with chapter 1, verse 14 of the book of Ruth. And it says, and they lifted up their voice and wept again. And Oprah kissed her mother-in-law, but Ruth clave unto her. You see, the difference is, one, it says right here, one, Oprah kissed her mother-in-law, but Ruth cleaved into her. She cleaved into her. And she said, behold, your sister-in-law has gone back unto her people and unto her gods, and return thou after their sister-in-law. Then Ruth said, entreat me not to leave, or return from me following after for you. Where you go, I will go. Where you go, I will go. Where you lodge, I will lodge. Where your people shall be, my people shall be. And your God will be my God. Where you die, I will die. And there will I be buried. And the Lord do unto me more also, but death part you and me. And when she saw, she steadfastly minded to go with her. Then she left speaking unto her. And she said unto them, call me not Naomi, call me Mara, for I'm bitter. For the Almighty has dealt with me bitterly. And went out of full. The Lord has brought me home again empty. The Lord has brought me home empty. Why then, ye me Naomi, see the Lord has testified against me, and the Almighty has afflicted me. Naomi returned with Ruth, the Moabite, her daughter-in-law, with her return out of the country of Moab. And they came to Bethlehem in the beginning of the barley harvest. You know, right here, this passage will show Ruth and Oprah as it would, one would follow Naomi, which Ruth would symbolize a type of church. Ruth would symbolize a type of church, and Naomi a type of a Holy Spirit. But I want to touch for a moment. I want to look into the beginning of this book. That way you guys have a little more understanding. Where Elimelech starts off, he starts sojourn with his two sons. And he goes into Moab, and a famine was caused in Israel. You see, sometimes the Lord will cause famines in our lives, whether it be spiritual or physical. He will cause famines in our lives to see if we're going to withstand that storm and to work out faith in a believer. To work out faith. To exercise one's faith. If one's faith is not exercised, it can never get to greatness. So as we find their faith being exercised in Elimelech, and he takes, you see, Elimelech was a priest of his home. He was a preacher. He was to lead God and his family at the moment to the sacrifice, which was in Judah, because he was from the tribe of Judah. But where there's always a Melech, there's always a Boaz. Hallelujah. Thank God there's always a Boaz. Thank God there was a Boaz that sits on the throne. Hallelujah. But Elimelech, I want to look into Elimelech's life, and as we get weary with our walk sometimes, we can come down to that barren land. And what did Elimelech do? He takes his two sons, and he takes his wife, Naomi, and he goes into this barren land because a famine had hit the land. And I ask you today, what is your famine? Is it spiritually? Is it not trusting in the Lord? Is it financially? Is it, I don't know what people, I don't know your problem. But this was Elimelech's problem. He was looking to bring your pastures. He was looking to he stopped trusting in that sacrifice that Israel of old had taught him. You see, he was from the line of Judah. He knew and understood the sacrifice, if we could say. Through this lineage would come the Messiah, Jesus Christ, through Boaz. Hallelujah. A relative, Amalek. And as you see Amalek's life, he would lead his family to Moab. What's so wrong about Amalek going down to Moab? If he's seen a famine within the land, if he's seen because he stopped trusting in God. He stopped trusting in God. He stopped trusting in his provision. That was his fault. He started looking. And that's what we do. We start looking to our circumstance that we're in. And God don't want you to look into your circumstance. But he wants you to look into Calvary. Hallelujah. Because that's where your circumstance was dealt with. Hallelujah. Thank God for Calvary. Thank God for Calvary. That's why we preach the cross here. Because our life was barren without Calvary. But there stepped in a man called Jesus. Hallelujah. He said, I have redeemed you from the land of the barren. Glory to God. Glory. I want to keep looking at Amalek because us as men, we are to lead our families into that land which God provided for us. It doesn't matter what hell presents to us. It doesn't matter what's going on in the spiritual realm. It doesn't matter what the devil's telling you about your financial situation. It doesn't matter if your mother and father shall forsake you, but God has not forsaken you. Hallelujah. He said, you guys are my children. Hallelujah. He will never leave you nor forsake you. You see, sometimes even us, when we're in a marriage relationship between our spouse, and sometimes there can be problems within our marriage. But see, a man and a woman, even they won't forsake you, but Jesus Christ will never forsake one. Hallelujah. Thank God for that. Thank God for that. You know, when I was a drug addict, I forsook my house. I forsook my family. I forsook my children. But God restored me. Because he's in the restoring business. He's in the changing business. He's in the taking what looks barren to one and fixing it. Hallelujah. You see, everybody said that's a barren situation there. My brother is barren. His life is barren. He's better off dead. That's what my situation was. I was barren. I was barren. My addiction had me barren. But as we find Amalek looking, so he goes to Moab. What was so important that would cause death upon this man and his children? What was so important that the Lord would have to turn his face from him? What was it? Was it the Lord said, man, I want death for you, Amalek, and I want death for your two children. Is that the Lord's way? Is that the way we're understanding him as a God that punishes and a God that's forsaken us, as a God that's left us on the wayside? No, it was Amalek going out of God's will. And that's what we do as believers. Sometimes we get into a situation, every boxing match is not going to be the same. You're not always going to face the same opponent. Are you guys understanding what I'm trying to say? Every situation in your life is different, but you got to know that where it looks barren, there is fruit. Hallelujah. Where there is death, there is life. Hallelujah. Because Jesus Christ hung on that cross 2,000 years ago and bore our sin. Hallelujah. So Amalek, he sojourned. He said, man, what astonished me is you see Boaz, maybe a cousin of Amalek, and he stays behind. And he sees Amalek going. But Boaz stands there. Hallelujah. He stands there. You know, if I could say, you know, he sees the pressure coming as a quarterback. He sees the pressure coming. He sees the line unfolding a little bit. You see, he got rattled a little bit by the circumstance and that famine in that land. But he stayed in the pocket. Hallelujah. He stayed in the pocket because that's the place of your safety. Hallelujah. Glory to God. That's one's place. That's one's position. Your position is not in yourself. Your position in Christ. When you're out of Christ, you're out of position. But when you come back and position yourself in Jesus Christ, the Lamb of God, that will say you are. You stepped into the arena of God. Hallelujah. That's what Paul said. You know, the church of Corinth was going astray. He said, for in him dwells the fullness of the Godhead. What was he saying? He was saying Jesus Christ, the Holy Spirit. And the Holy Spirit and the Godhead, the power, the deity part, was there. They were all there from the beginning. He was slain before the foundations of the world. Slain for us. And we think, man, you know, the gospel is a little hard. The sin was harder. Sin hit you with rigor. It was never a little bit. It was never a, you can taste sin and it's not going to take you further than you want to go. Because it was so rooted in the heart that it was to destroy a man, that alcoholic, to take that first drink. He don't want to leave his family. He don't want to just chase that bottle. Then he finds himself chasing that bottle. Why? Because that was the outcome of sin. That was the outcome of sin. It destroyed man's heart. That's what it does. It moves you away from the very presence of God. And that's what happened with Amalek. He seen something in the world. He sees something in the world that attracted him to the world. He sees something that attracted him to the world of Moab. What was Moab? Moab would signify the world. He was striving after the world. He was striving after the world. He went towards Moab. And why did God, why was it important that God had to depart from Amalek? Why? Why would God, the Lord of Israel, his covenants were established from generation to generation, tying them back to the seed of Abraham? Why? Why would he leave them? Why would he abandon Malak? Why would he forsake his child of God? Because God can't dwell in sin. God can't dwell out of his will. God only can work in the perimeters of Calvary. He can only work in the framework of the cross. When you leave, spiritually speaking, when you abandon the cross and your faith is not there for every circumstance in life, you will find yourself. God's will slowly lead you. And it doesn't matter, it doesn't mean it's going to happen instantly. But his grace start running out. And I've seen it. I've seen it in believers. And I was just sitting here praying for them. And sometimes I think, man, I wish I could get into their mind and rewire them. That's the work of the Holy Ghost. That's the work of the cross. Hallelujah. That's Jesus' job. You see, when we step in, we cause nothing but failure. But when he steps into the arena, he causes nothing but restoration, healing, and deliverance. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. So Amalek, man, you know, when I read this, I wept. When I read this passage, I wept because it showed me how fast the enemy can use a circumstance in your life and cause you to leave the sacrifice, which is Calvary, our faith planted there, our faith trusting what he did, our faith knowing that he's going to meet every need through what he did at the cross. So Amalek goes with his two sons, goes into the world, a child of God. Law had been engrafted in his heart. The Mosaic law had been engrafted in his heart. Thou shalt not lie. Thou shalt not have no other gods before me. All this was engrafted in his heart that he finds himself. Amalek and his two sons. You know what's harder is when you lead the ones you love into a place of perishing. And that's what Amalek did. He would take his two sons and he would go down to Moab. Seeking provision, seeking what his need was at the time. And he would go down to Moab, and his sons, this was unlawful what he did. This was unlawful according to the law of Moses. It was unlawful because he takes his sons and they marry into the world. They broke every commandment, if we can say. But the saddest thing is, that as he takes them to what looked good to the eye, to what looked pleasing to the flesh, as he followed it, his situation looked barren, so he leaves Israel. He leaves the place of the synagogues. He leaves the place of the sacrifice. He abandons the church, and he strives after the world. And he sees himself with great, great pain, which didn't affect him because he died. It affected not only the one he loved. It affected his wife. It affected his wife in the matter that she lived to see the bitterness. She said, the Lord has caused me to be bitter. Why? Because her husband died out of the will of God. Her two sons died. And this is spiritually speaking, and this is what's happening in the modern church today. They're spiritually dead. And the priest in the home, the one that's supposed to lead and guide their families into the Holy of Holies, into the very presence of the Lord, is perishing by the wayside. We're perishing as man, not leading and guiding our families. Not leading and guiding our families, not trusting, not looking to the sacrifice as every need. Not knowing, and it's a lack of not knowing that He is the great I am. That He is the great I am. But what do you mean? As He presented Himself to Abraham, as He presented Himself to these patriarchs of old, that I am, that I am, that I am whatever your need is today. Hallelujah. And He will meet your need. Hallelujah. He will. Because He is the great I am. So Amalek goes down. There he goes with his sons marry Ruth and Orpah. So they marry these two women, which followed false gods. You know what happened? You know what happened to their faith? Their faith got destroyed. Their faith, I'm talking about the sacrifice faith. I'm talking about what they believed in. I'm talking about the rituals that was engrafted in the heart. I'm talking about what they were taught that I determined to know nothing. Save Jesus Christ and I'm crucified. It was all gone. If we could say, they had perished. They would find themselves in Amalek and his sons perishing by the wayside. Which Naomi would claim later on, this situation has caused me to be bitter. The only thing that could arose in Naomi that I could say after going through trials and tribulations and at a hard state and being hit with rigor, which it was their sin. Their judgment was upon sin. So I say strive away down into Moab, striving hard after the world. They strove hard. And that's what we do sometimes. We strive hard after the world. We strive, I don't know what your God is today. But whatever it is, you need to get rid of it. I don't know what it is. But it needs to go. Because it's an idol. It's a god of Moab. And that's what Naomi had to do within herself. She found herself in a situation where she said, I'm bitter. I'm nothing. I'm empty. There's nothing good that dwells in me. She found herself in that state. And nothing good dwells in me. I call myself Mara now. I become bitter. I'm a bitter woman. And then we look and we say, man, would God cause bitterness upon a child of God? Would God cause such rigor on a child of God that was oppressed on her? Would God cause that? Even as the children of Israel, you look at them. Would God cause that? God will move away. And He'll let you do what you gotta do. He'll let you strive after Moab. He'll let you run hard after Moab. But let me tell you something. He had to leave her because God can't dwell in a place of sin. God can never dwell in a place of wrongdoing. God can never dwell in a place of wrong direction. But He can only dwell where His will is. Are you guys hearing me today? Where His will is. What is His will? Calvary. That's His will. You know, many people say, well, I want to do God's will. I want to be in His will. That's what Shipley said. I want to be in His will. What is His will? You being planted in Calvary. You being a joint heir in Calvary. You knowing that you died and you risen in the newness of life that Calvary's brought. You knowing that you are a new creation, that all things have passed away, but you are a new creature now by the power of the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. So we're looking at this situation, and you see Orpah. It was one of the daughter-in-laws, but you see Ruth, two Moabites, Gentiles. But Ruth, in this picture, would represent the church. Naomi, after her situation, something arose within her. Something arose within her. Faith arose. Hallelujah. Faith arose. Now, there might have been not a lot of faith. It might have been, as Jesus said, as small as a mustard seed. But faith rose up in this woman. And she said, man, I am bitter. Hallelujah. I call me Mara because I became bitter because of my situation. And what Calvary. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank God there's always a solution. Thank God your heavenly Boaz is always sitting on the throne and will receive you. It doesn't matter what you've done. It doesn't matter how bad you sin. But your heavenly Boaz is sitting on the throne and is ready to welcome you. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Thank God. Man, because I think sometimes I say, man, if I was Jesus, I don't think I would be so forgiving. I died for you guys, and you guys turned on me, I said. You guys only think I'm only good for salvation? No, I'm good for victory. I'm good for justification. I'm good for sanctification. That blood still washes all sins away. That blood that was shed 2,000 years ago can still save a sinner from the power of the darkness. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. So you find Oprah. One looked at her mother-in-law Naomi and said, man, we're in a pretty bad situation here. You know, and Naomi, she was looking for something. She was looking for help. She was looking for help. And then she looks at Ruth. And Ruth, loyal to her, a type of church, a type of hearkening to the Spirit. You see, Naomi, from her circumstances she was in, all of a sudden she becomes a type of Holy Spirit. Are you guys hearing me? She becomes a type of Holy Spirit in the way that she will bring the church back unto Boaz. Hallelujah. Glory to God. You see, she recognized her situation. And Ruth, being a church of Gentiles, she wasn't even engrafted into the law. And she didn't have privilege to be in the synagogue and to sacrifice and partake of the tabernacle. She was just an onlooker, but all of a sudden faith rises up with her. Hallelujah. And she said, when you go, I shall go. When you die, I shall die. Your God shall be my God. Hallelujah. That's the God that's looking for individuals that'll stand firm in the faith, that'll stand steadfast in the faith. I say, when you die, I will die. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Glory to God. All of a sudden, this woman became Naomi's friend. Can you imagine that? Can you imagine the words, the encouragement that came into this woman that was a widow and just lost her 2 sons? And she tells her, man, where you go, I shall go. I shall be your daughter. Hallelujah. I know the circumstance that you were in, but I want to go where you go. I've heard of this God of Israel. Hallelujah. I know the all-powerful. So he sees. So now, and this is spiritual. Oprah would go back to her gods. This is what's going on in the spiritual realm. Oprah would go back to her gods. And Ruth would strive after the gods of Israel. She was striving after the gods of Israel. So what happens? What happens after all this journey back to Israel? And it was harvest time. There was two men. One was married according to law. The only way they could be redeemed was if they were redeemed. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. The only way they could be grafted back into Israel was through redemption. Everything those 2 sons owned. The father of Abimelech, a relative of Boaz. Boaz would redeem them. Hallelujah. That meant that those men were gone. But Boaz was to carry on. Hallelujah. He was to carry on the lineage. Glory to God. You see, they were from Judah. Glory to God. This was Jesse's father. Glory to God. And then came King David. Glory to God. And through the seed of David, all country and the world was blessed. Glory to God. So we find them. And all of a sudden, Ruth, Naomi would send her. He would say, go glean the field, Naomi. Go glean Boaz's field. You know, and according to law, the reapers would gather. They would leave a little bit in the corners of the harvest, of the field. They would leave a little bit on the corners, on the edges. And there, when Ruth gathering, it was for the poor to glean the corners of the harvest. It was for the poor. God had instructed. It was his type of welfare, if we can say. It was God's welfare to the poor at the time. But Boaz see Ruth, and he had heard that she was a righteous woman. He had heard about her. You know, people were talking to Israel. People were talking about Naomi's back. But she came with a different name. She came bitter. She came empty. And that's the way you got to come to Calvary. Hallelujah. That's the way the Holy Spirit will always bring you to Calvary. He needs to bring you empty. He needs to bring you broken. He needs to bring you when you said, I'm bitter. I can't make it anymore. I'm desperate for you, Holy Spirit. I need a touch of you. And that's when God can start working in the inner realm. That's when God, that's when you left your will and you sought His will. That's when you said, I crucified with Christ, but yet not I, but Christ liveth in me. Hallelujah. That's when you ran your race. Hallelujah. That's when the conversion is taking place in your heart. When you realized that you were bitter, that you were in a hopeless condition, that you couldn't do nothing, but you needed help from up above. You see, it's easy to forget what Christ has done for us. It's easy. We could just, within a blink of an eye, we could just strive towards the world as they did. Lead our whole family down into the wrong path. Lead them into a place that's going to worldlize them for not trusting that God can provide in a famine. That God could, He's the God that provides in the famines. Hallelujah. He is the God that can build a well in the midst of your famine. He is the God that can smite the rock. Hallelujah. In the wilderness and bring them water. He is that same God. He is the same God that led us through a fire by night and a cloud by day. He is the same God. That water is still flowing from deep down within. You just got to know Him. You got to know Him. As you go. So as Naomi tells her, it's harvest time. Go glean the field. And Boaz, she finds grace. The church, hallelujah, hallelujah. The church found grace in the sight of heavenly Boaz, a type of Christ. Boaz was a type of Christ. And he said, leave her a little bit on the corners that she may feed. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And as she reaped the corners of that field, day after day, Naomi would instruct her. The Holy Spirit is instructing her how to tend to Christ. Hallelujah. The Holy Spirit will always instruct you how to tend to your feet. Are you getting me? It is till you reject them. When you reject them, striving after the world, the Holy Spirit will literally step out and let you go into that valley of death. Even David claimed, he said, though I walk through the shadow of the valley of death, thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff shall comfort me. What is a rod? Calvary. Calvary. So she's gleaning. She gleans the field. And Boaz finds grace. She finds grace in the sight of Boaz. She's gleaning it with the reapers. He tells the reapers, leave her a little more. This is a Amalek's kindred. It wasn't a coincidence that Amalek was related to Boaz. They were from the same line. They're from Judah. So whatever, hallelujah. So as she's gleaning the field, Boaz finds grace. So she finds grace in the sight of Boaz, the type of Christ. She's gleaning that. That those fields, the Holy Spirit will give you a little bit here and a little bit there. But next thing you know, He'll give you the field. Wow. Hallelujah! Hallelujah! He'll give you the revelation of power wherever it needs this minute. And as Ruth, she came back to Boaz. And I want to make this statement regarding Ruth. Everything the devil meant for evil, God turned it around for the good. He couldn't help them in their situation that they had abandoned His will. They had abandoned His sacrifice, not knowing that they were going out of the will of God. But when they come back into His will, He can only bless a believer in His will. Are you guys hearing me today? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. He can only bless when you're in His will. He can only bless when your faith is in Calvary. He don't bless nothing else. Well, why would He say He don't bless nothing else? There's many people preaching Jesus. They're going down to Moab. That's what they're doing. Because there's no sacrifice. They offer a peace offering. You see, and this is a problem with many believers. They will offer you a peace offering. They will say, we believe in the cross by salvation, but we don't believe in it for sanctification. We don't believe that the cross is everything you need. We want to use ourselves, our minds, and our thoughts, and our powers. And that's where it becomes a problem. That's where you've altered leaven. And that's what they did. They went down to Moab. They altered their faith. Their faith, they did more than alter it. They didn't have less than abandoned the faith. But when Ruth comes, she gleans, and Boaz, she finds grace. And Naomi, the Holy Spirit, look where He leads her. She said, go find Boaz. As he rested, lay at his feet. When she laid at his feet, that was a perfect cross. Symbolized Calvary. Symbolized Calvary was a perfect cross. So Boaz, as he would go, you know, he talks to the church. You know, Boaz is a godly man. He talks to the elders. Is there anybody that will marry this? There was another man from Judah. He will not qualify. He will not qualify to marry Ruth. Because he was married already. It would have been unlawful. But Boaz was single. You see, it was all orchestrated by the Holy Spirit. Every situation, you know, it's mostly us that do the wrongdoing. But the Holy Spirit always brings you back to a land of provision. Are you hearing me today? Hallelujah. You see, the Holy Spirit always brings you back to a place where all needs are met. And that's what happened between Naomi. She realized her condition. She realized that she was bitter. She realized that she had been through hell and back. And she had even changed her name. Mara, I'm bitter. She realized. And that's a condition sometimes of falling. We don't realize that we need our heavenly Boaz. Because we want to do it. But as Naomi tells her how to tend to Boaz, and she lays at his feet, a type of cross, meaning everything, all grace is found in Calvary, and she lays there. Boaz will marry her, and as he will marry her, he redeemed her. Hallelujah. It symbolized a redemption plan. It symbolized Calvary. He redeemed her back from her fallen state, back into the sacrifice of Christ and Him crucified. Hallelujah. Thank God that our promise still stands. Thank God that Calvary still stands. Thank God no man shall follow. The church won't follow. But we shall follow because we know that the sacrifice is the only thing that defeated the powers of darkness. Hallelujah. This passage is beautiful in my heart as I read it. You know, man, I preached it prior to this, but as I seen, and we do sometimes, we get weary in our walk. We get weary because sometimes we think that, man, that God's not going to meet that need for you. And we start looking at other places. And that was the whole, what caught my mind out of the most thing I knew and understood grace. I mean, I'm telling you, if anybody understands the cross, man, I think I understand it pretty well. But it wasn't a lack of not understanding the cross. It was a lack of going out of God's will. That's what caught my eye. And the Holy Spirit quickened me. The word steadfast. Let me talk about it. It says Ruth was steadfast in her mind. It means she had came to a place of determination. Hallelujah. Are you hearing me this morning? She came. I'm reading out of verse 18. She came, she said, she was steadfast in her mind. She was steadfast that she had, you see, and that's what we got to do. We got to be like Ruth. When we talk about Ruth, and yes, she inherited Boaz's land. Yes, she inherited the harvest. Yes, she inherited, but she became steadfast in her mind. That's what caught my attention also. She became steadfast. She said she came to a place of determination. She came to a place where Moab wasn't enough. She came to a place where Moab didn't satisfy the needs no more. Are you hearing me? I'm telling you, you can strive after the world as hard as you want. You can strive after those foreign gods. You can even strive after that other Jesus that the church is preaching today. But he shall not satisfy your need. But Calvary will. Hallelujah. Calvary will preach that word. Glory to God. Hallelujah. That's what we do. We strive. But Ruth, she said she was steadfast. She knew those gods were dead. Amen. You see, it was the same thing when Abraham came out of the land of Ur. He said, he heard a voice. He said, come out, Abraham, he was 75 years old. Man, he was done. He was an old man. His wife was barren. Again, barren. You find barren throughout the Bible. She was barren. The Lord calls him out from a wealthy place, from a place of the world, idol worshiping. Abraham probably produced more of these false Jesuses than anybody else in the world at the time. And why I say he's false Jesus is because he's not from Calvary. Amen. Paul said he's another Jesus. And nobody want to pull the blankets on him, but I will. That's what we're here for. Because I came out of that other Jesus that diminished the cross. That said that's not the power of God. There was other stuff. But there isn't no other stuff. Paul said, Christ sent me not to baptize, but to preach the gospel. Not in wisdom, the word. Let the cross be of none effect. The word, what he's talking about. He's talking about man's philosophy. He's talking about man's ways other than the cross. He's talking, he said, get out of here with your philosophy, Church of Corinthians. Get out of here with your philosophy, because your philosophy will lead you to the pit of hell. The cross of Christ. That's what we need. We need more preachers that'll stand here and that'll stand the famine. You see, a lot of preachers will say, man, I want to go where the people are. I want to go where the crowds are. And I can easily do that. I can easily go where the crowds are. I can easily go where everybody's at. But no, I came to a place where I found, I said, it may look barren. It may look like sometimes I'm in my hell. It may look like I'm going to make my bed in hell. Hallelujah. Man, Emmanuel preached this great message on Wednesday about God walking through shadow, valley of death. And David claims he's under the feathers of the Almighty. And those feathers, no angel has feathers. You know, the church today says angels have wings and feathers. And they draw these angels, these furry angels with feathers. But they don't have feathers. The only ones that have feathers is cherubim and seraphim. They're the beasts. They're these beasts that cry before the Lord. Hallelujah. That's why David said, let me hide under the feathers of the Almighty. Glory to God. What was he talking about? Because there is safety where the God is. There is safety where the Holy Spirit goes. There is safety, hallelujah, where Jesus Christ is. There's safety there. Don't place yourself at a place of safety. When you abandon Calvary, you place yourself in death. That's what it is, spiritual death. You know, before in the outer courts, Israel had a kill-off sin. Can you imagine that? Can you imagine if the Lord said, man, you gotta go kill off sins, literally. You gotta go kill people. But no, the Holy Spirit now, he dwells and brings life to a believer. Through the Spirit, everything became spiritual after Christ. Joshua had slain the Amorites, the Ammonites, the Jebusites. He slain all these. But now everything becomes spiritual. Everything becomes spiritual. So what do you mean? What are you saying to me? I'm saying that the Holy Spirit quickens a believer. The Holy Spirit always, the Holy God will never lead you into a place out of Calvary's cross. He won't. You know, a lot of people say, well, it's God's will for me. God's will is not for you to leave Calvary. I'm sorry. God's will was never for you to abandon the cross. God's will was never for you to dwell outside of Jesus Christ and Him crucified. Why? Because that is the gospel. I don't care. You know, I would stand toe to toe with any preacher or even elder or whatever you must that'll say that it's Jesus and it's not the cross. Because that offends what He did for me. You're offending God's redemption plan. Are you guys hearing me? And that's what we do from
time when we strive after more, we're offending God's redemption plan because we're saying what you did there wasn't sufficient. Is that sufficient to meet needs? Is that sufficient to meet any? It's not good enough to serve this bondage I have. It's not good enough to heal me. It's not good enough to deliver me. It's not good enough to restore my marriage. Our message is, don't be an Amalek. Don't be an Amalek. Those young men, don't be Amaleks. Leave your family. You guys are going to have families. But lead them into the sacrifice. Lead them into the sacrifice. And that's why it burns my heart that every soul that's been here and has heard the gospel and has gone in another direction, it causes death. Spiritual death. Separation from God. That's what it causes. And this whole picture of Naomi and her husband dying and her sons, that was their spiritual condition. Can you imagine that? You know, many people don't think that your spiritual condition matters. But if you're not connected in the spirit, God is the spirit. So if you're spiritually poor, then how are you planted and grafted in God if you're spiritually poor? How can that be? That's why he said to Laodicea, to the church, he said, I have passed by and I have knocked on your door. And when I knocked, you did not open. You said, I am rich and good and I have you nothing. Can you imagine that? That was the Holy Spirit knocking our hearts, knocking our lives, and saying, you have need of nothing. You see, the Holy Spirit examines. He's an examiner. He examines the heart, man. He's everything. Hallelujah. But the whole picture was, sometimes we do go into that barren land. Sometimes we look into other places, into the world. But God always has a plan. He always has a redemption plan. He always ready to redeem everybody. He's always ready to take the broken and glue them back together. And he's ready to mend the broken hearted. Hallelujah. I worship to make your way back. Hallelujah.